Eastridge Presbyterian Church, with the community of Eastridge Presbyterian Church. Melody, we're doing this.
I know. We are preparing this morning because we are going to have people worshiping with us in person here in the sanctuary, but we wanted to give it a try and make sure that we knew how to do this. So we have some folks who are here worshiping with us. Shout out.
Who will give us constructive feedback. And while we'll try to figure out things like, where is the camera again?
But we are really excited to have you all worshiping with us this morning and really want to welcome those who are worshiping with us wherever you may be this morning. It's a beautiful and glorious day outside, which is great. So if you're outside and maybe you're going for a walk or you're sitting on your porch or maybe you're inside, wherever you are, we are excited to be worshiping with you on this day.
That's exactly right. And what we have... a couple folks here are worshiping with us here in the sanctuary, and we're so glad that you are here with us too. And this is an experiment.
It is. But we would invite you, if you are worshiping with us in person and you want to let people know that you're here, please do go on Facebook. We will not be offended. In fact, we would be encouraged for you to participate in what's happening in our online community. And for our online community, we want to say hello to Christy and to Greg and to Sharon and to Daryl and Deb. Welcome to worshiping with us, and to all of those who have not yet been able to chat and say hello, please do so so that we know that you're here.
One thing we want to announce is that by April 3rd, which is
2 weeks.
2 weeks from today, we would invite anyone to join us here in the sanctuary for this service at 10:30 as well. And we welcome you through whatever means you join us.
So our goal is that if you're worshiping with us online, that it would be an experience sort of like it is today. We might fine-tune it a little bit, but it would be an experience like today where we're all live, all of our musicians and everybody is live. And then there would be people in our sanctuary who are worshiping and you all joining us online. Some folks call it hybrid. I call it magic. It seems magical to me, but anyway.
Yeah, we invite you to take a look at The Lamp, which is our weekly news and views about what's happening in the life of the church. You can find the link to The Lamp. You should have received that in your email, or you find it on our website, eastridge.org, linked there, with all the different activities that are happening right now or soon to happen. And as every week, we invite you to take a close look at our list of prayer concerns, joys and concerns. And I do want to lift up a particular joy that we celebrated this week. We celebrated the birth of Jimmy Nelson, who is the grandson of Sheila and Leo Schumacher and the son of Hannah and Jack Nelson. And he was born on March 12th, a little bit over a week ago. And the family is doing well, and we are excited to welcome a new little feet and hands on this earth.
Yes. We also want to share a joy. Stephen Kong, who is a member of our community, a member of our congregation, has been for the last 2.5 years trying to go through all of the things that need to happen so that his wife can join him. He's been married just over 2.5 years, and his wife has been in the South Sudan this entire time. So just before the pandemic, I wrote a letter on behalf of our congregation sharing that we would be excited. We are excited and looking forward to welcoming Stephen's wife with us. She will join us at the end of May. So a huge praise that all of the paperwork and everything has been granted, and she will be able to join Stephen this May. And we would invite you all to help us welcome her.
Yes, and as every week, we invite you to share your joys or your concerns in the chat if you feel comfortable doing so. We would ask that you share your story, not someone else's story. We'd like to include you in our prayers as well. With that.
I think it's weird to be sitting next to you, Thomas.
And not seeing each other through the screen. I want to say it's good to be sitting next to you here on this part.
Thank you. Yeah.
With that, dear friends, let us center ourselves on this day with our hearts and with our minds for our time of worship. On that day, so many years ago, the people saw Jesus and asked, "Who is this?" So in worship, we respond. In worship, we declare Jesus is the Alpha and Omega. Jesus is our teacher and preacher. Jesus is a miracle worker and healer. Jesus is our source of love. Jesus is our path in the wilderness. So may we lay down our hearts like they laid down their coats. Let us worship Holy God.
Of glory coming on the clouds with fire, the whole shades, the whole shades. I see his love and mercy washing over all our sins. The people sing, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. I see a generation rising up to take their place. The selfless faith. I see a near revival stirring as we pray and see. We're on our knees. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Heal my heart and make it clean. Open up my eyes to the things unseen. Show me how to love like you have loved me. Break my heart for what breaks yours. Everything I am for your kingdom's cause. As I walk from earth into eternity. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
Please join us in prayer. May we wave palm branches and shout Hosanna and proclaim you, Lord, and follow you as love enters the world, as justice comes among us, as peace finds its way, and truth becomes known.
May the story of then happen now. So in the places of hunger and famine, may we who can ride in with sharing reveal a new way of living together.
In places of loneliness, may we who can ride in with compassion reveal a better way to share together.
In places of conflict, may we who can ride in working for peace reveal a safer way to live with each other.
May we be like you and proclaim God's good news and tell the world about the work of love and what it does.
May our hosannas be good news for those in the world who need your care and hope.
Hear us pray for the world and for our friends and family, those who are ill and those recovering.
Hear us, we pray, in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray together, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Water you turned into wine, open the eyes of the blind, there's no one like you, none like you. Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God. Our God, into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? Then what could stand against? Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? What could stand against?
Good morning. What if I told you I was going to shout the word Hosanna today? Would you know what we were celebrating in the church year if I said that word? If you thought Palm Sunday, you would be right. Then your brain might start working very quickly and you would wonder, wait, next week isn't Easter. Today isn't Palm Sunday. Confused. Why did you say that? Well, if you thought all of those things, you are correct. Today isn't Palm Sunday. But we're going to talk about Jesus entering Jerusalem. We are going to do this because this story comes next in the order of stories that we have been talking about in the book of Matthew. And really, it isn't a bad idea to talk about things early because sometimes that helps us to get ready for what is coming. At least it does for me. So before I share the story of Jesus entering Jerusalem with you, I want to ask you if you have ever been in or to a parade. Now, I want to share a couple pictures with you from when I was in a parade. There it is. I grew up in Grand Island, and every October, there is a parade called the Harvest of Harmony Parade. These pictures are from when I was in junior high and was in the band. The first picture is of the whole band, and we are coming down the main stretch where most of the people are. We are all in unison and playing some upbeat music. Now, this second picture, there I am, right in the front there, marching down the street playing my drum. I can remember that when we walked by the spot where most of the people were standing, they were clapping and cheering for us. They were showing us how excited they were, and they were cheering us on. If you've ever been in a parade or watched one, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Now, I want you to think for a minute, what do you think that parade would be like if Jesus was in it? Do you think people would clap or cheer or greet him? Well, I want to share today's Bible story with you, and I bet we might find out what people thought when they saw Jesus come to town. When Jesus and his disciples were at the Mount of Olives, just outside of Jerusalem, Jesus called two of the disciples and said, "Go into town. Right away, you will see a donkey tied up with a colt. Untie them and bring them here. If anyone asks what you are doing, just say, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will let you take them." Now, the prophets had said that the king would ride into Jerusalem on a donkey and a colt. So this pointed to Jesus as that king. So they went as Jesus asked them to, got the donkey and colt, and Jesus rode into town. There were lots of people around when they heard Jesus was in town. They began to spread their coats on the road in front of them and cut down branches from the trees and put them on the road for him to ride on like a carpet. The crowd was shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David! He is so blessed. Hosanna, way up in heaven. When they finally reached Jerusalem, everyone was abuzz. Who could this possibly be that is causing such excitement? When we think about it, welcoming is a really easy way to show someone we care about them. Now, Palm Sunday is also about shouting, Hosanna! And praising God. In the Lenten bags that I gave to you, there is something in there that talks about prayers. It says that prayer is a good thing for us to practice during Lent, really all the time, but to focus on during Lent. When we try to do this every day, it's something that becomes a habit. Using prayer to praise God is a great way to remember Jesus riding a donkey into Jerusalem. Everyone was so happy that Jesus was there and all the things that Jesus did for them. We too should be happy about all that Jesus does for us. So in addition to thinking about welcoming others, I want us to do this too. Pick something that you do every day. Maybe brush your teeth, eat lunch, or maybe it's put your seatbelt on when you get in the car. And when you do whatever that thing is that you're thinking about, I want you to also take a minute and say a prayer that praises God. It doesn't have to be long. It can be as easy as saying, Jesus, we love you. Whatever that prayer is, then I want you to end that with a big, loud, Hosanna! All right, friends, would you pray with me, please? Dear Jesus, Hosanna! We praise you for who you are and living in our heads, our hearts, and all around us. Amen.
Well, I once again want to just say thank you all for joining us online. And Greg Tubach is talking about how he marched in that parade as well. And I really appreciated seeing Miss Chris play the drums. Had no idea. Had no idea. Drummer in the house. So it is a joy to welcome you all again and to be here worshiping together. It might look a little bit different this morning because we are getting ready to invite folks to come back and join us in person in the sanctuary as we worship together, and it does feel good to be gathered together. I want to pick up where Miss Chris left off with Matthew chapter 21, verse 12, but before I do, let us turn to God in prayer. O Lord God, we come to you today with great joy in our hearts, great hope, and hosannas on our lips. We come to you with the excitement of children as we hear this story on this unusual Sunday, as we hear the birds singing and feel the warmth of the coming day in our town. We come to you this day knowing that even as many of us have joy in our hearts, there is also sadness, fear, regret, concern, anxiety. We are ever aware of our need for your healing presence in our lives. So we pray that you would descend with great power wherever we may be, that you would open our hearts and our minds to your presence in our lives, that we might joyfully share with others the good news of Hosanna. We pray all this in your son's name. Amen. And so our scripture text continues in Matthew chapter 21, verse 12. Listen now again for the word of the Lord. Now Jesus entered the temple courts and drove out all who were buying and selling there. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the benches of those selling doves. It is written, he said to them, that my house will be called a house of prayer, but you are making it a den of robbers. The blind and the lame came to him at the temple, and he healed them. But when the chief priests and the teachers of the law saw the wonderful things he did, and the children shouting in the temple courts, "Hosanna to the Son of David," they were indignant. "Do you hear what these children are saying?" they asked him. "Yes," replied Jesus. "Have you never read from the lips of children and infants, O Lord? You have called forth your praise." Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Now, I don't know about you, but for me, when we sing these songs, when we hear this text on this beautiful day in Lincoln, Nebraska, everything comes together and it can only mean one thing. Because when I'm surrounded by these clues, I have feelings. There's assumptions and ideas. There's memories that bubble up. And they all mean one thing, that it's Palm Sunday. That Easter is around the corner. That it's the beginning of Holy Week. Now, maybe the same thing is true for you, and maybe it's not. Maybe you're as familiar with these texts and these clues as I am. Maybe you remember the parades of Sunday school children who are waving palms and the clever prayers and the words of worship about palms and palms. Maybe you'll be singing hosannas for the rest of the day, and maybe it will feel all week like Easter is just around the corner. Maybe not. Palm Sunday isn't really the same as a high holy day like Easter or Christmas. And so maybe you're coming to this text this morning with an openness and an awareness that anything here can happen as we tell this story from Matthew's point of view. Now, it's really tricky, isn't it? Because it's not really Palm Sunday. It's not the Sunday before Easter. It's not the beginning of Holy Week. And yet, when we were planning out the texts for this narrative arc in Matthew, we felt that it was important to keep the story Matthew is telling intact. Being good Presbyterians, we checked with the right committee. And Hosanna, they agreed. That these songs are just too great. That we can sing them more than once a year. And that maybe this text would sound different, maybe it would feel different if it came to us in new and different ways. After hearing the text that precede it in the gospel, maybe it would be like a hidden gem, and hopefully not like a sore thumb. Well, for me, it is a hidden gem. As many of you know, Matthew is a really tough gospel for me. And so it's been really helpful to have Thomas and our friend Dr. Richard Swanson and Chris Adler Bremer interpret it for me. Now, I have to tell you that I'm not sure that I'm loving it yet. It's not for me like my beloved Gospel of Mark. But I'm at least learning why I struggle with it more. As Richard pointed out last week in our after chat conversation, we share the same struggle with the Jesus that Matthew is sharing with us. And he seems very angry, very absolute, this Jesus, with a lot of yes ands and a lot of yes and no's. I much prefer the ambiguity of a yes, but also maybe, and no, but not always. I like the dynamic and charismatic Jesus of Mark's gospel, but I find the Jesus of Matthew a little, he's not warm and fuzzy. This isn't the chum to share my thoughts and secrets with. This isn't the peaceful presence that I believe we are called to share, and so I struggle with it. So it's why this text sticks out. It's one of those wait a minute texts that Miss Chris shares with us. Like the parable of the unforgiving servant, like the parable of the workers in the vineyard, only this one isn't a parable. This is Matthew telling a real life event, a real life story. And so in this text, which follows the blessing of children, a mother then trying to secure her two disciples, her children, her two disciples' position in the coming kingdom, after a text of healing of the blind men, Jesus, this somewhat certain fellow who tells extreme stories and gives extreme examples and teaches extreme lessons, who has already been identified by the disciples as the Messiah, this Jesus, Matthew's Jesus, rides into Jerusalem on a donkey. And not just a donkey, but the foal, or a baby donkey. And some scholars argue that depending on how you read the text here, that extreme Matthew has two donkeys, really taking it home that this is not Jesus arriving in a big emperor's parade on a horse. So Jesus, all of a sudden in Matthew, is gentle. The crowds around him gather and he doesn't teach and no one is healed and there's no huge banquet. Gentle Jesus rides into town on the back of a donkey, on the foal, on the colt, on a baby donkey. And so maybe it's the crowds here who are extreme. As they gather and they shout, Hosanna, which doesn't mean hip hip hooray. It means save us. Like any crowd, we can expect some of them to be crying out fervently, looking desperately for someone to lift them out of their miserable and uncomfortable lives. But anyone who's ever been in a crowd can also imagine that maybe there are a few who were unconvinced, but who have been overcome by the emotion of the crowd, who have been swayed by the overwhelming crowd. Maybe they become believers and fans as this man rides so gently in their midst. And then, of course, there are likely those who are just going through the motions, who are unconvinced, who are skeptical, who are thinking to themselves, what kind of king comes into town gentle and riding on a baby donkey? Maybe they shout anyway just because they feel that pressure to conform. And it's something that we've heard before, but we just can't ignore the background for Matthew's telling of the story. Because the historical context in which Matthew is living is one of rubble and destruction. The lives the people of God once knew have been shattered in the wake of a war, of the first Jewish revolt. Their lives have been disrupted and overturned without stability and security. And for many of us, we unfortunately have stories of what it means to live like this. As I think about the people in our congregation, in our community, as I think about what's happening in the world, I know that there are many of us who have stories of what it means to live in a diaspora, which is kind of a fancy word, but it simply means to be spread out from your homeland, from your place of origin, unable to go home again. Unable to go home because it doesn't exist any longer like it did. And maybe some of you and some of us carry these reminders, live with these reminders of lost community, of empty buildings, of places we once considered sacred, empty. And of course, as we tell this story today, we don't need any more images of that would be like. They flash across our screens. We can easily call them to our minds. We see them as we hear the stories, as we read the headlines. Yes, from around the world, and yes, from here in our community. If any of that resonates with you today, Matthew is speaking to you. Matthew is speaking to a community whose lives are in a literal ruins. I did find it very helpful last week in our after chat that Richard Swanson shared the effects of the PTSD the community was living with. And I love that he pointed out that it's possible that it's not actually Jesus who is angry and absolute. It's possible that it's Matthew. Yes, working out some of his post-traumatic stress disorder, trying to understand how this Messiah, this one on whom all of our hopes of saving, this Messiah rode through town gentle and on a donkey. For those who need saving, the question pops up, what kind of king is this? What kind of Messiah is this? Or what kind of people? Swanson says this, when Jesus rides into Jerusalem in the company of crowds who acclaim him as a prophet, as the son of David, they make it clear that Jesus stirs hopes that have lived deep within the Jewish people, hopes that have helped them resist domination through all the centuries since the Babylonian exile. That was the last time that their temple was destroyed and God's presence wasn't to be found with God's people. And for Swanson, there is a sort of covert element here that shouting the unintelligible language of Hosanna, of save us, to someone who is as non-threatening and gentle riding on a donkey means that those who do not understand would not understand. And we need to know that. That's important. That's key for us. Because we carry questions into the very next scene. Because this is the angry Jesus again. The very first thing this gentle Messiah on whom the hopes of the Jews rest is to go to the temple, which makes sense. This is the first thing that he does. And he fashions a whip and he destroys the temple, which does not make any sense. Unless the temple, the place where God maintained the peace and stability of the world, has already been destroyed. Now, there are strong connections throughout Matthew's gospel with the prophet Jeremiah, who saw the destruction of the temple long before the destruction of the building. As the Babylonians dismantled everything of value, took everything of meaning out, before then walking the Jewish king and his family away as prisoners to exile. And so in this text, the Messiah goes into the temple. The Messiah himself goes into the temple. The Messiah himself disrupts the appearance of peace and stability because he knows that God is no longer providing peace and stability in that place. That God is no longer bound to that place. That it has been corrupted by the Babylonians centuries ago, and it's now being corrupted by the Roman government. Matthew and his audience see here a Jesus that will not allow God's temple, that will not allow the sacred to be profane. The temple has already been destroyed. Jesus is just clearing it out. I don't know about you, but I really need a word of hope from this text. And so I am relieved that Jesus then does something, because I think this is the part that we can hold on to today, that this is the message that we can carry. This is where the hope of the story lies, because this is the Jesus that I long for. Jesus begins healing. Jesus begins healing. And here's the message that I believe Matthew is wanting to convey to his community, to his neighbors and his friends and his family. Jesus begins healing. Even though at this point in the story we might be wondering how, especially when we know it gets worse before it gets better, that Good Friday is coming before Easter Sunday. Jesus begins healing. Those who have never been able to go into the temple before. Those who did not have to fulfill their religious duties and sacrifices because they could not. Scholar Anna Case Winter says it this way: instead of being a marketplace, the temple becomes a healing place. Jesus receives the blind and the lame and heals them. And this doesn't seem remarkable until we remember that the blind and the lame were exempt from obligation to attend festivals in the temple. They were permitted to do so, but they could not draw near. They could not offer sacrifices. They could not offer food in the temple. They could not serve as the role of priest. The hosannas ring out and ring true. Save us. It's the children who crowd around and who shout, Hosanna, save us, as Jesus heals those who have never been in the temple before. Save us, the crowd cries to the gentle king, born in a stable, taken to Egypt as a refugee, riding on a donkey. Now, during all of this, the tension in the story grows, and it becomes really, really complex. And like any tragic event in history, we wonder again and again, how did this happen? Who is responsible? Because we long to find the place or the person to point our finger, to identify the source so that we can prevent it from happening again. But that's not the answer that Matthew is providing here. How do we make sense of everything that is happening, everything that has happened? In the midst of all of this chaos and complexity and things that we don't understand is the story of us, of you and of me, and of how God comes to us in Jesus Christ. And this is the reason that we gather, that we hear this story, that we shout Hosanna today, save us, even as we try to understand that which we cannot. Friends, this is Hosanna, the message that we are called to go out into the world and to share. Save us, Jesus, even as we see him riding amongst us. Because God comes to us in Jesus, in a smelly barn, born to teenagers, as a refugee, as a king, riding on the foal, on the colt of a donkey. This Jesus heals us. Hosanna. Amen.
Who loves us with an everlasting love. Glorious God, we gather in the name of your Son, Jesus. We come to worship and adore you, not as a mindless crowd following a fad, but as devoted disciples, ready to offer all that we have, as Jesus offered all that he had so that we might have life. We have come united in our love for you, our only God, whose love for us is beyond our wildest imagination. Gracious God, help us to accept that you offer us full forgiveness. God, give us the grace to love and forgive others as you love and forgive us, and to seek to say sorry to those people we have hurt. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Your God has come to you, humble in the form of a slave, to free you from all that threatens to separate us from God and from each other. Friends, you are loved by God. In the name of the one who is exalted beyond what we can comprehend, Christ, our Savior and Lord. Our Savior comes to us humbly, riding a donkey and proclaiming a message of peace. So, friends, let us now turn to each other. in the chat, wherever you are, and share the peace of Christ with each other. Friends, the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all.
We want to thank you again for joining us. This is a a little bit different for us because we are worshiping in the sanctuary, and we do have some folks who are here worshiping with us, and in 2 weeks' time, we will welcome more people. We just wanted to try it for a couple of weeks before we went live with both. So we're going to get some feedback, and we really appreciate that feedback. I want to invite you to stay for our after chat. We do have an after chat. It is pre-recorded, but it's really good, and we invite you to stay and to have conversations. It's with our very own Miss Chris Adler Bremer, and her husband, who also happens to be Chris Bremer, and they share job titles as well. So they're going to stay and talk to us about how we can do more of what she talked about in the worship connection this morning, how we can have conversations, and how we can bring spirituality into our everyday lives as families. And there's a book that we're using for that discussion by Tracy Smith, and it's called Faithful Families. So there you go. So please do join us. And before we go, I want to encourage you all. This word is so encouraging to me as it comes from Matthew, because I don't want to deny what's happening in the world and what's happening in our community. And even in the midst of feeling so much joy and hope and wonder at what God is doing and what God is bringing up out of things that I think are dead and ruined, that God is doing new things. But we do need to share this message that this is God who saves us, that this God is riding amongst us gentle and on the colt of a donkey. Friends, let us be called to action to share this faith with others so that God would move us to share our hosannas. God would move us to proclaim God's name. God would move us to announce God's kingship to the waiting world, showing others on this road that we will always be God's people this day and always. Hosanna. Amen. Well, I want to welcome everybody who is joining us and watching us for this after chat. And full disclosure, we are recording this earlier in the week, but you can still use the chat and let us know that you're here, and we will chat back with you. And if you're joining us from First Presbyterian Church or from the Presbytery, we welcome you as well. We are so excited to be able to have this conversation. I'm excited to be able to have this conversation because it's such a gift to have Chris and Bubba in our Presbytery, and such a gift that my family received one of those books by Tracy Smith about Lenten practices and Easter practices
for faithful families. But I do want to start off by saying happy anniversary.
Thank you very much.
To Chris and Chris. The two Chrises, how often do you get confused?
All the time.
Yeah, quite a bit. Quite a bit.
Well, in part, it's because you share so much. Not only do you share first names spelled with a K, and you share a last name because you are married 9 years today.
Yes. Yep.
You share a house because you're married. You share dogs because you're married. And you share this amazing vocation. So
that is a lot of sharing. I don't realize there was that much sharing.
Do you have like different passion, like different hobbies, or do you share hobbies as well?
No, we pretty much have our own hobbies, I think.
But they're all creative in some way, most of them. He's far better at hitting a golf ball than I am.
I do know that because my husband, Steve, has golfed with Bubba before. And that's not yet a hobby that I participate in.
But. We hope to share that a little bit more this summer in playing golf together. But for the most part, we have kind of our own different little hobbies in the house. Right now, my hobby is stained glass. I've been doing a lot of that. We're learning to do more and more of that and kind of thing. So, but that and woodworking and for me. So,
well,
Chris
has
been tearing it up by reading books.
Ooh.
I cannot keep up with her.
Well, it's all about picking the right book, you know.
It is. It's true.
And then it goes fast.
But there's so many good books out there. So many good books out there.
There are.
Well, I think that one of the things that we are so fortunate, and maybe we don't know, maybe we don't talk about this enough in this presbytery, is that you both have come to us to serve at churches in this presbytery, and you both bring a good bit of experience. And you partnered together with our churches this year to share that experience with our presbytery through this book by my friend Tracy Smith, she's written another one. It was called Advent. Oh, here, Chris, so good.
A little Vanna White, you know.
She wrote one for Advent. And then this one just came out for Lent. So can you share a little bit of the genesis of the idea of working together, which I love, but working together and then sharing this with the presbytery. So who started it and how did it go from there?
Go ahead, Chris.
I was going to say, who wants to speak first? I think, the idea of sharing it and coming together as a group, youth ministry and children's ministry in the church is such a why would we not work together and share what we're doing? Because none of what we do we want to say, this is mine and I'm not sharing it with anybody else. And so really the way that this Faithful Families book is written, it's just really so accessible that, you know, putting something together that's a little more focused to say, you know, here's a few things that you might pick out so that it doesn't look so overwhelming. You know, we've already done it and put it together. Like, why would we not offer that to somebody else and maybe help out, another church that really could use that resource? Just because we have so many churches in our presbytery that don't have a paid educator on staff. And while we cannot run our churches without volunteers in our programs, sometimes to put those things together, it takes a lot of hours to do that. So, why would we not share?
The idea of we are individual churches, but all individual churches are working towards the same goal. And why would we not help one another in achieving that goal and sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ and how it reforms? And everybody has their gifts and expertise and skills, and the idea that if we all kind of share those with each other, that makes us as a whole makes us better and makes us stronger.
So you all have put this together. The presbytery did help with some funding for it, and providing some books for those churches that wanted to participate. And I know that my house received a bag and a book and a beautiful little, I don't want to say a condensed version, but it was so wonderful to receive something that says like, here's a few, because I think it's overwhelming to start. It's overwhelming for me as a pastor. Like, I hope my kids get some of this. Can it be, you know, not trickle down economics, but can it be trickle down faith? Like, hopefully just me modeling it will get some, but like, how do I be intentional about sharing with my kids why Lent is important? Especially when a lot of different traditions don't observe Lent. Lent isn't a part of their tradition. So thank you for making this available. Are you looking for feedback from folks? You want some feedback from churches and how it's going?
I think that's always helpful, you know, because we can sit at our desk and look at our trusty resources here and say, here's what I think might translate to people. But, you know, we really don't know what that's going to be for a church or for a family, you know, what is going to strike them as meaningful or important. You know, and I think one of the things, you know, that you touched on, Melody, is that the book has some great ideas, which I think are all, you know, accessible to folks, but we don't know where people are in their conversations in their homes with, you know, how extensive are your conversations, or are you really just going, hey, we need to start this. So to put something together that says, here's a great place to start, but there's far more in the book. So if we've picked out the wrong one, which is possible, there are 10 other options that you can look at. And the things that are in there are mostly stuff that are around your house or that you can find. So it's easy to say, we're going to substitute this for that. But it's always helpful for us to know as well, you know, did that work? Did we just deliver a bag to you that you're like, this is just more stuff and this didn't help us? Or is it, oh my gosh, these were great and we want another book. So that feedback is always helpful.
Yeah. Chris kind of mentioned the context of every church is so different. That's a challenge for any curriculum or book that is written is, will it really, how well does it translate to their particular kind of context, which I think is what Chris did in writing, excuse me, you know, I have the copy of the booklet here that Chris really did put together. She did most of the writing. I just handled some of the technical sign-up stuff, that kind of thing. I was her assistant on this. But what she did with the booklet is, in picking out just a few of those ideas, is she also created kind of a model of, okay, so maybe that particular one doesn't work for you, kind of thing. But you can see how we adapted or took one of those suggestions from Tracy Smith and made it a little bigger, a bigger thing to help them understand you could pick any one of these. And here's the way in which you can expand upon what you're doing in the, you know, with your family and how you can make connections with the community and whatnot. Because, you know, even for, you know, for us, a lot of it can be written with our community in mind of, you know, here in Lincoln, which, you know, the opportunities and resources outside the church are going to be far different here in Lincoln than they would be even in Hickman or Ord or, you know, Verdigre or wherever, you know, wherever amongst the presbytery. Our presbytery is quite broad in its size and just the size of churches and type of churches and resources. So I think Chris did a great job of kind of modeling how to adapt the various different activities in the book to, you know, individual families and how you can expand upon those.
Well, as a parent, my children are 9 and 10, and we look forward to the bags and to everything that's in them. We've gotten them over the course of the pandemic. I think it's a beautiful ministry model to get, but I have to tell you, as a parent, there's a lot of stuff and a lot of places where I look and I see what I should be doing. And I think that we're really good at this as parents, as I'm looking and I'm trying to keep up with the Joneses. Like, I never experienced this until I was a parent. Like, it's a thing. Like, you show up and you're there to pick up your kids at school. And like, it's so like, what are you doing? And I don't want to say it's competitive, but there's so many good ideas that we should be doing. So many great subscription companies that, you know, we come in the mail and it's like, you set it aside and we should be doing. So I just kind of want to let other parents know that this resource is not meant to be lived through like A, B, C, do it all. That it really is pick and choose. And I've really appreciated that all of the resources that we've gotten have been that way, because some things really hit home and they're amazing. And some things it's like, this isn't for us right now, but we're going to keep it because it's good. My kids just weren't, you know, my kids just aren't in the right frame space. Like on today, they want to be outside playing baseball, I'm sure. But
as they should be. Yeah.
As they should be.
That's what nice weather and spring break is for.
That's right. Mm-hmm. That's right. But I think it's just so great to have had those pulled out, you know, Chris pulled out to say like, these are things, this is a way to start. And it's not, you know, it's not like a finish. So those of you who may not know who Tracy Smith is, I know her from back in the day. We were young pastors starting out together in the Presbytery of Detroit. And since that time, we've both gotten married, and we both have had kids. And so she lives a pretty full life. So what sorts of things are in this book? Like, is this going to take us 5 minutes to do? This is going to take us half an hour to do? Are there quick things? Are there, you know, what sort of time commitment does talking about faith entail?
So I think the answer to your question is yes.
The great answer.
And one of the things that I was thinking as you were talking about as parents, I think, you know, I like to think a lot of this stuff in just how you would think about conversations and helping your child, like with reading at school. You know, you want to read with your kids outside of school because you want them to have more exposure to reading and those kinds of things, whereas faith would be the same. So, you know, you want to have those faith conversations outside of the time that they are in education classes at church. But really the nice part about those conversations is there's no right or wrong answer in these. So it doesn't, I want parents to have more of a comfort with when something comes up to say, gosh, I really don't know the answer to that, or that's something that we can talk about further, or those kinds of things. So sometimes those conversations and activities, you know, might be a 10-minute activity that you're going to do real quick around the dinner table when you're done, and then everybody's off to whatever it is that they're doing. And some of those conversations and activities might be more like 30 minutes because it's a new way or a new conversation for a family to think about or do things. And so you're going to talk about that a little bit further. And sometimes I think that's based on what questions your kids have. You know, they are really great at taking a conversation in a direction you never knew you were going to go. but sometimes those are the best kinds of conversations because it takes parents there as well. And it's just a really genuine conversation or a way to work through something.
I think to some degree, the practice is maybe even more important than the time spent. Even if it's a short amount of time, even a short conversation or just a couple of questions at, you know, at the dinner table that don't last more than 2 or 3 minutes, the practice of doing those and making that part of your tradition or your faith process at home or faith formation at home can be just as valuable. And then as you're getting used to that, I think typically things tend to grow. Kind of a thing. So you may start off and only be a very short amount of time, but might expand to that, but into longer amounts of time. But again, get back to what Chris kind of mentioned earlier, it's kind of your own context. You know, families are busy and busier than ever. A big part of it is really just kind of carving out sometime, you know, for it, whether it's daily or weekly or, you know, however that, you know, that kind of happens. But the more that it becomes part of your life, especially your life at home, the more it becomes ingrained and becomes a part of our natural thinking and natural processes of life.
Yeah, you said that, Bubba, and my heart sank. My heart sank because, and I've shared this before, that sort of the early days of the pandemic, while there was certainly a fear there and a stress that I'm still like coming out of and trying to sort out and make sense of, there was also a beauty for my family for those days. And so the opportunity to talk about what was happening and what would, you know, like we had opportunity to do that. But as you said, families are busier than ever. And my heart sank because I so like during those days, I was like, we're never going to go back to that. But guess where we are.
Yep.
And I think that from my perspective and my experience and what I'm hearing from other parents, it really is trying to now blend in those traditions that we maybe started during the pandemic and those opportunities that we started during the pandemic. It's now soccer season. It's now baseball season. It's season for a lot of sports to be back. And so how do we balance that and still maintain those traditions? And I just think it's important, but I want to confess that I struggle with it. Like I'm a parent too. And I certainly, I rely a lot on our ministries here at Eastridge for our kids to learn about the Bible and stories. And yes, we talk about it sometimes at home, but by no means am I like, hold me up as an example, because I am a struggling parent myself trying to find time to do this.
Well, and I think sometimes I, as parents, they need to let themselves off the hook for how intentional, it's going to sound weird, how intentional and how long it should be. Like we set up in the booklet that you take a week and you have a spiritual practice for the week. So the first week is prayer. And so do you know what, as you're taking off your seatbelt to get out of the car to go into school, hey, God, be with me today as I'm in school today. Amen. Like you can't get your seatbelt off that fast, but you've just engaged in a prayer practice that can be something that you do every day. You know, everybody in the car can say it together, and it really hasn't added any other time to your day, but it's just something that you you do as you go about your day, which really is kind of, you know, what we want those faith practices to be, is that it's just ingrained in who you are and what you do. So sometimes I think it's like parents, families, let yourself off the hook. It's okay. And if you do it Monday and you forget to do it Tuesday, do you know what? It's okay. Do it Wednesday. Like it's okay.
Yeah. And I think sometimes the faith formation at home can be a challenge and difficult for families to think about, because their model that they have is what they experience at church, which, you know, as you know, I see this all the time in asking people to pray at the end of a meeting or the youth to pray. They're like, well, I can't pray like you all pray in church on the spot. Like, well, neither can I. You know, I have books.
look at all these resources.
Exactly. You know, I mean, I have books that are just on just prayers. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, I spend, you know, my children's sermon for, you know, my 3-minute children's sermon, I spend a good hour or more preparing for that. And, you know, the prayers that we have in church, they don't have to be all flowery and wonderful language and, you know, faith invoking stuff that goes on at home. It's just the recognition, you know, kind of, you know, part of it. And so in some ways people see what happens at church, they forget the amount of time and effort that goes into crafting that. But that's the model they have. That's what they think it needs to be. Faith formation doesn't have to be an hour-long lesson with crafts and, discussion questions and a video, I mean, kind of a thing. Faith formation at home can be much like these practices. Just spend a little time in, you know, 10 seconds in prayer, just thanking or just being, you know, cognizant of, you know, we have food on the table. Thank you for that. We're blessed in recognizing that. And oftentimes I think it's just the practice of connecting what we do, because I think we do things that are Christ-like, but we don't always think of them as being Christ-like or living out as examples of living out our faith. The being kind to someone, we talk about that, just being kind. Well, we're kind because God tells us, love one another. And just by the simple act of recognizing that when you are kind to someone, you are showing God's love, takes all of 10 seconds to do, but just recognizing that why we do what we do because of God and because of Christ in our life makes it, I think, you know, makes a difference whether it's 10 seconds or whether it's an hour, you know, kind of activity. So Chris is right. It doesn't, parents, you know, with their busy lives, recognize that it is, and just find those little moments of time when it can be, of when you can talk about things or share about things. It makes a huge difference, I think.
I think that's when it becomes more of a practice too, because, you know, you're not going to sit down for an hour and hold hands and bow your heads and have prayer time. Like, that's just not how it's going to work. But if you say it as you're taking your seatbelt off in the car to go into school, like, yep, you know what? I got that one. I can do that. And so then it becomes, you associate it every time you are going to take the seatbelt off. Like, here comes an automatic thing. You know, think about how many of us now are uncomfortable not putting a seatbelt on in the car. All of us grew up of an age where I didn't wear a seatbelt as a kid, but now it's just an automatic thing. So once you start that, it continues.
Yeah. But here's my true confession. Because my prayer life is very, spontaneous. And it always has been. Like, even when I went to college and there were a lot of people who were like, oh, you know, I'm going to set aside some quiet time. Like, I have never had a faith life like that. It's always been like, it's a beautiful day. God, thank you for this day. So like, how do I model that for my kids or whatever, you know? So then I go, this is a true story. This week, my parents are in town. And so meals are a little more formal than they usually are. And Steve doesn't have practice in the evenings right now. So we're like taking advantage to sit down and eat as a family, which is so foundational for me. As a family, I want to sit down to eat. But I'm also often very worried about not having hot food, because part of my role right now and responsibility is cooking the food. So it's like everything in me is trying to get the food on the table. And we don't always pray before we eat. But this week, everybody else at the table is like, no, we have to at least pray. But nobody wants to do it. So they all look to me, paid prayer. This is my prayer. This is honestly my prayer before we eat. Lord God, thank you for this food. Amen. And they'll make fun of me because they're like, oh, you've got these long prayers. And like, you can offer those long prayers for everybody else. But I'm like, but that's not actually what this is. What this is we're sitting down as a family, and I am very thankful for this food and mindful of that. So I think, you know, just to the point of like, it doesn't have to be long but like really all of those things that people are like, oh, that prayer was so awesome. We have awesome resources and we continue to, you know, go through those resources and prayers hit us and we love to share them with others, and yes, sometimes it does come off, you know, the top of our head, but it's always inspired by something else. You know, it's like that was this past Sunday we had Richard Swanson preaching. It was a great sermon. And I prayed, but I had good, good thoughts, you know, like yeah. I had somewhere to go from. It wasn't like, I was just like, oh, here's a prayer. So I think that from the heart for me has always worked best as a spiritual practice.
Well, and I think that's it. Cause a lot of times in and I have more of these conversations with the youth and with the children, but, you know, I kind of often say to them, like in that instance there, do you think God is really going to have an opinion about whether you prayed before you ate or you went, ooh, I need to pray and pray in the middle? Like, I don't think God really cares where in the meal that you did that. it's the act of doing that that's more important. And so it's like, you know, where is the, what is the thing that we need to be hung up on and let the other one go? I recently had a conversation with somebody that said, oh, my granddaughter was laying down in the pew. And I wanted to go, well, that's okay. Like, do you know, she's in church. It's great that she's here and she's learning part of the ritual of worship and those kinds of things. It's okay if she's laying down. It's okay.
Yeah, you bring up probably the most common family tradition practice is praying before meal. And it's, you know, in reality, that the blessing of the meal, the food, was, you know, from farmers who were thankful for this. I mean, you know, who didn't go to the store and buy everything, but grew it, you know, and harvested it and prepared it, you know, and they're thankful that they're able to do that, you know. So I've never looked at the meal blessing as asking God to bless it, but more of thank you for what we have. And as Chris said, we can thank God for what we have before we eat it, while we eat it, after we eat it. Many times I've had some really delicious food and I have thought, oh man, thank you, that is so good. You know, I mean,
thank you, dear Lord, for this amazing corn.
Yes.
Because I was out yesterday in beautiful Barnston, Nebraska, where I met some of our good folks from the Presbyterian Church in Wymore, Nebraska. So if you are from that Presbyterian Church and you were watching, hello, it's beautiful country. It's very dry out there. And I asked, how will we have corn this year? Like, it's been so dry. And are you worried? And a beautiful, beautiful woman who her and her husband farm at, she said, we've done this all before. She said, 2 years ago, that field, or 3 years ago, that field was underwater. And this year, we need rain. We need rain at the right time. And if rain doesn't come, we'll figure it out, because that's what we've done. So this summer, when I'm eating that corn, and I think about what amazing work went into that from the farmers and from Mother Nature, from the soil, you know, thinking about all those things and talking about all those things, living here in Nebraska, it's easy to do because you don't have to go very far to find a connection to a farm, no matter where you live.
Right, right.
No matter where you live. So that's great. I want to thank you both so much for spending this time on your anniversary. It's a little bit earlier in the week, but I did want to catch this. And Bubba is at First Presbyterian Church, and so hoping things are going well for you there and you're back in person.
We are. Oh, yeah.
Still some online options over there.
Yep. Still navigating how things are, and, you know, we take it a month-by-month basis on, you know, what our procedure or policy will be or how we go going forward, kind of thing. But going well.
Good.
Going well.
Good. And I think a lot of us are really in that same position. One of the things that we talk about a lot here is that the reopening has really happened so fast. We were just talking about it yesterday, you know, to think about what did I say, Chris? Like 3 weeks ago, our choir wasn't yet practicing. Mm-hmm. And so, like, to pull off Good Friday services and Monday, Thursday services and Palm Sunday services, like, they usually are practicing on that since the beginning of January. And so to try to pull everything together, just want to kind of normalize that for all churches out there and for all of the people in the churches. It's a lot of good folks and good saints coming together to make it happen. So and let us know if you're watching this and you are from Wymore or Niobrara, or you're from a community that received one of the resources. I think we would love to hear back from you about how it's going. I would love to see us do something like this again as a presbytery in the future. We feel so blessed. I feel so blessed to have you both here in this presbytery.
Well, thank you. And I would say we have some additional books. So if there's folks that we're like, wait a minute, I want, it's never too late. And there are also, she does include after Easter resurrection things as well. So it's not too late, and we can definitely arrange to get a book to whoever, wherever.
Yeah, and they can be used year after year. It's not like it's a one-time, a one-time deal that once you've used it, the practices, things you can do that are always good reminders, because even the more that we good habits that we adopt, they tend to fall off by the side while, when other things happen and lives get busy, and can always pick them up again. So yes, if you haven't gotten a copy, would like a copy, we certainly have extra. We have some extras. We'd be happy to get to you.
Thank you both so much. And this is me. Chris and Bubba would never say this, but between the two of them, their experience, knowledge, and wisdom is well known and respected in the GA, and they are just wonderful resources. And I am so thankful. I think about this often, how thankful I am that you are both in this presbytery, because it makes it's such a great resource, and it makes us all, I don't want to say easier to access, but it's much easier to access. To get in your brains. Your brains are such beautiful places, and also very well organized. I'm noticing both of your offices are very organized.
Oh, you can't see my desk right here.
Okay.
Everything got shoved over for this.
Well, thankfully I had a moment last week of, I need to clean. So
I was here for this. She was like, I'm cleaning my office and I probably should be doing something else, but I can't live like this anymore. Then she came in my office today and I saw her run screaming out. So, all right. God bless you both. Thank you all. And let us know that you're engaging in this great resource.
Thank you.